This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. President of the United States Campaign for the Presidency 1960 Inauguration Presidency Timeline New Frontier Foreign Policy Doctrine A Strategy of Peace Bay of Pigs Cuban Missile Crisis Civil Rights Address Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty Clean Air Peace Corps We Choose to Go to the Moon Space Programs Mercury Gemini Apollo Assassination and Legacy November 22, 1963 State Funeral Eternal Flame Memorials Library Legacy VE The Presidency of John F. Kennedy lasted from January 1961 to November 1963 Kennedy, a member of the Democratic Party and the 35th President of the United States, took office after defeating Vice President Richard Nixon in the 1960 presidential election at age 43. Kennedy became the youngest elected president, the first president born in the 20th century, and the first and to date only Roman Catholic president Kennedy served as president until he was assassinated in Dallas, Texas on November 22, 1963 He was succeeded by Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson Kennedy's time in office was marked by Cold War tensions with communist states, especially the Soviet Union and Cuba. In Cuba, a failed attempt was made at the Bay of Pigs to overthrow the country's dictator Fidel Castro in April 1961. Kennedy's administration subsequently rejected plans by the Joint Chiefs of Staff to orchestrate false flag attacks on American soil in order to gain public approval for a war against Cuba in October 1962. It was discovered that Soviet ballistic missiles had been deployed in Cuba. The resulting period of unease, termed the Cuban Missile Crisis, is seen by many historians as the closest the human race has ever come to nuclear war between nuclear-armed belligerents. Kennedy also increased the number of American military advisors in South Vietnam by a factor of 18 over his predecessor, Dwight D. Eisenhower. A further escalation of the American role in the Vietnam War took place after Kennedy's death. Kennedy was unable to pass many aspects of his New Frontier domestic program, but his presidency saw the establishment of the Peace Corps, developments in the space race, and the Trade Expansion Act to lower tariffs. Kennedy took steps to support the civil rights movement, and after his death his proposed civil rights bill was passed as the Civil Rights Act of 1964 Contents 1 Personnel 11 Administration and Cabinet 12 Judicial Appointments 121 Supreme Court 122, Other Courts 2 Inauguration 3 Foreign Policy 31 Vienna Summit 32 Bay of Pigs Invasion 33 Cuban Missile Crisis 34 Latin America and Communism 35 Peace Corps 36 Southeast Asia 37 American University Speech 38 West Berlin Speech 39 Israel 310 Iraq 311 Ireland 312 Nuclear Test Ban Treaty 313 List of international trips 4 Domestic policy 41 Economy 42 Federal and military death penalty 43 Civil rights 44 Civil liberties 45 Immigration 46 Native American relations 47 Space policy 5 Assassination 6 Legacy 7 See also 8 Notes 9 References 91 Publications Personnel Administration and Cabinet Kennedy brought to the White House a contrast in organization compared to the decision-making structure of former General Eisenhower, and he wasted no time in scrapping Eisenhower's methods. Kennedy preferred the organizational structure of a wheel with all the spokes leading to the president. He was ready and willing to make the increased number of quick decisions required in such an environment. He selected a mixture of experienced and inexperienced people to serve in his cabinet. "We can learn our jobs together," he stated. Kennedy's brother, Robert F. Kennedy, served as Attorney General, and the younger Kennedy was often referred to as the Assistant President, in reference to his wide range of influence. Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson was largely sidelined during the administration. The Kennedy Cabinet Office named term President John F. Kennedy 1961-1963, Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson 1961-1963. Secretary of State Dean Rusk 1961-1963 Secretary of Treasury C. Douglas Dillon 1961-1963 Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara 1961-1963 Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy 1961-1963 Postmaster General J. Edward Day 1961-1963 John Agronowski 1963 Secretary of the Interior Stuart Udall 1961-1963 Secretary of Agriculture Orville Freeman 1961-1963 Secretary of Commerce Luther H. Hodges 1961-1963 Secretary of Labor Arthur Goldberg 1961-1962 W. Willard Wirtz 1962-1963 Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare Abraham A. Ribicoff 1961-1962 Anthony J. Celebres 1962-1963 Judicial appointments Supreme Court Main Article, John F. Kennedy Supreme Court Candidates Further information, list of nominations to the Supreme Court of the United States Kennedy appointed the following justices to the Supreme Court of the United States, Byron White. John F. Kennedy's inaugural address John F. Kennedy takes the presidential oath of office administered by Chief Justice Earl Warren on January 20, 1961, at the Capitol Kennedy was sworn in as the 35th president at noon on January 20, 1961 in his inaugural address he spoke of the need for all Americans to be active citizens, famously saying, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." He asked the nations of the world to join together to fight what he called the common enemies of man, tyranny, poverty, disease, and war itself. He added, "All this will not be finished in the first 100 days, nor will it be finished in the first 1,000 days, nor in the life of this administration, nor even perhaps in our lifetime on this planet, but let us begin." In closing, he expanded on his desire for greater internationalism. Finally, whether you are citizens of America or citizens of the world, ask of us here the same high standards of strength and sacrifice which we ask of you. The address reflected Kennedy's confidence that his administration would chart an historically significant course in both domestic policy and foreign affairs. The contrast between this optimistic vision and the pressures of managing daily political realities at home and abroad would be one of the main tensions running through the early years of his administration. Foreign Policy Main Article, Foreign Policy of the John F. Kennedy Administration. Vienna Summit. Countries visited by Kennedy during his presidency. President Kennedy's foreign policy was dominated by American confrontations with the Soviet Union, manifested by proxy contests in the early stage of the Cold War in 1961. Kennedy anxiously anticipated a summit with Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev. He started off on the wrong foot by reacting aggressively to a routine Khrushchev speech on Cold War confrontation in early 1961. The speech was intended for domestic audiences in the Soviet Union, but Kennedy interpreted it as a personal challenge. His mistake helped raise tensions going into the Vienna summit of June 1961. Kennedy with Kwame Nkrumah, the first head of an independent Ghana, March 1961. On the way to the summit, Kennedy stopped in Paris to meet Charles de Gaulle, who advised him to ignore Khrushchev's abrasive style. The French president feared the United States' presumed influence in Europe. Nevertheless, de Gaulle was quite impressed with the young president and his family. Kennedy picked up on this in his speech in Paris, saying that he would be remembered as the man who accompanied Jackie Kennedy to Paris. On June 4, 1961, the president met with Khrushchev in Vienna and left the meetings angry and disappointed that he had allowed the premier to bully him, despite the warnings he had received. Khrushchev, for his part, was impressed with the president's intelligence, but thought him weak. Kennedy did succeed in conveying the bottom line to Khrushchev on the most sensitive issue before them, a proposed treaty between Moscow and East Berlin. He made it clear that any such treaty which interfered with U.S. access rights in West Berlin would be regarded as an act of war. Shortly after the president returned home, the USSR announced its intention to sign a treaty with East Berlin, abrogating any third-party occupation rights in either sector of the city. Kennedy, depressed and angry, assumed that his only option was to prepare the country for nuclear war, which he personally thought had a 1 in 5 chance of occurring in the weeks immediately after the Vienna summit. More than 20,000 people fled from East Berlin to the western sector in reaction to statements from the USSR. Kennedy began intensive meetings on the Berlin issue, where Dean Acheson took the lead in recommending a military buildup alongside NATO allies. In a July 1961 speech, Kennedy announced his decision to add $325. The following month, the Soviet Union and East Berlin began blocking any further passage of East Berliners into West Berlin and erected barbed wire fences across the city, which were quickly upgraded to the Berlin Wall. Kennedy's initial reaction was to ignore this, as long as free access from West to East Berlin continued. This course was altered when it was learned that West Berliners had lost confidence in the defense of their position by the United States. Kennedy sent Vice President Johnson, along with a host of military personnel, in convoy through West Germany Germany, including Soviet armed checkpoints, to demonstrate the continued commitment of the U.S. to West Berlin Bay of Pigs invasion. Main article, Bay of Pigs invasion. The President and Vice President take a leisurely stroll on the White House grounds. Fulgencio Batista, a Cuban dictator friendly towards the United States, had been forced out office in 1959 by the Cuban Revolution. Batista's successor, Fidel Castro, affiliated with communism and the Soviet Union, giving the United States a potential adversary located less than 100 miles from its shores. The Eisenhower administration had created a plan to overthrow Fidel Castro's regime. The plan, led by the Central Intelligence Agency CIA, with help from the U.S. military, was for an invasion of Cuba by a counter-revolutionary insurgency composed of U.S.-trained, anti-Castro Cuban exiles led by CIA paramilitary officers. The intention was to invade Cuba and instigate an uprising among the Cuban people in hopes of removing Castro from power. Kennedy had campaigned on a hard-line stance against Castro, and when presented with the plan that had been developed under the Eisenhower administration, he agreed to back it despite his reservations about stoking tensions with the Soviet Union. On April 17, 1961, Kennedy ordered what became known as the Bay of Pigs invasion. 1,500 U.S.-trained Cubans, called Brigade 2506, landed on the island. No U.S. air support was provided. Alan Dulles, director of the CIA, later stated that they thought the president would authorize any action required for success once the troops were on the ground. By April 19, 1961, the Cuban government had captured or killed the invading exiles, and Kennedy was forced to negotiate for the release of the 1,189 survivors. After 20 months, Cuba released the captured exiles in exchange for $53. In late 1961, the White House formed the Special Group Augmented, headed by Robert Kennedy and including Edward Lansdale, Secretary Robert McNamara, and others. The group's objective, to overthrow Castro via espionage, sabotage, and other covert tactics, was never pursued. Cuban Missile Crisis. Main article, Cuban Missile Crisis. Meeting with Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev in Vienna in 1961. On October 14, 1962, CIA U-2 spy planes took photographs of intermediate-range ballistic missile sites being built in Cuba by the Soviets. The photos were shown to Kennedy on October 16. A consensus was reached that the missiles were offensive in nature and thus posed an immediate nuclear threat. Kennedy faced a dilemma. If the U.S. attacked the sites, it might lead to nuclear war with the USSR, but if the U.S. did nothing, it would be faced with the increased threat from close-range nuclear weapons. The U.S. would also appear to the world as less committed to the defense of the hemisphere on a personal level. Kennedy needed to show resolve in reaction to Khrushchev, especially after the Vienna summit address on the buildup of arms in Cuba. Kennedy addressing the nation on October 22, 1962, about the buildup of arms on Cuba. Problems playing this file. See media help. More than a third of the members of the National Security Council NSC favored an unannounced air assault on the missile sites, but for some of them this conjured up an image of Pearl Harbor in reverse. There was also some reaction from the international community, asked in confidence that the assault plan was an overreaction in light of the fact that U.S. missiles that had been placed in Turkey by Eisenhower. There could also be no assurance that the assault would be 100% effective. In concurrence with a majority vote of the NSC, Kennedy decided on a naval quarantine. On October 22, he dispatched a message to Khrushchev and announced the decision on TV. The U.S. Navy would stop and inspect all Soviet ships arriving off Cuba. Beginning October 24, the Organization of American States gave unanimous support to the removal of the missiles. The president exchanged two sets of letters with Khrushchev. To no avail, United Nations UN Secretary General U Thant requested that both parties reverse their decisions and enter a cooling-off period. Khrushchev agreed. Kennedy did not. One Soviet-flagged ship was stopped and boarded. On October 28, Khrushchev agreed to dismantle the missile sites, subject to UN inspections. The U.S. publicly promised never to invade Cuba and privately agreed to remove its missiles in Turkey, which were by then obsolete and had been supplanted by submarines equipped with UGM-27 Polaris missiles. This crisis brought the world closer to nuclear war than at any point before or since. In the end, the humanity of the two men prevailed. The crisis improved the image of American willpower and the president's credibility. Kennedy's approval rating increased from 66% to 77% immediately thereafter. Latin America and Communism. Main article, Kennedy and Latin America. President John F. Kennedy with Chilean President Jorge Alessandri, on an official official visit in December 1962 arguing that those who make peaceful revolution impossible, will make violent revolution inevitable. Kennedy sought to contain the perceived threat of communism in Latin America by establishing the Alliance for Progress, which sent aid to some countries and sought greater human rights standards in the region. He worked closely with Governor of Puerto Rico Luis Muñoz Marin for the development of the Alliance of Progress, and began working towards the autonomy of the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico when the president took office. The Eisenhower administration, through the CIA, had begun formulating plans for the assassination of Castro in Cuba and Rafael Trujillo in the Dominican Republic. Kennedy privately instructed the CIA that any such planning must include plausible deniability by the U.S. His public position was in opposition. In June 1961, the Dominican Republic's leader was assassinated. In the days following the event, Undersecretary of State Chester Bowles led a cautious reaction by the nation. Robert Kennedy, who saw an opportunity for the U.S., called Bowles a gutless bastard to his face. Peace Corps Executive Order 10924. Establishment of the Peace Corps. John F. Kennedy's announcement of the establishment of the Peace Corps. Problems playing this file. See Media Help as one of his first presidential acts. Kennedy asked Congress to create the Peace Corps. His brother-in-law, Sergeant Shriver, was its first director. Through this program, Americans volunteered to help underdeveloped nations in areas such as education, farming, health care, and construction. The organization grew to 5,000 members by March 1963 and 10,000 the following year. Since 1961, over 200,000 Americans have joined the Peace Corps, serving in 139 countries. Southeast Asia. Main articles: Laotian Civil War, 1963 South Vietnamese coup, arrest and assassination of Go Dinh Diem, reaction to the 1963 South Vietnamese coup, Cable 243, Buddhist crisis, Thich Quang Duc, Xa Loi pagoda raids, Krulik Mendenhall mission, and McNamara-Taylor mission. When briefing Kennedy, Eisenhower emphasized that the communist threat in Southeast Asia required priority. Eisenhower considered Laos to be the cork in the bottle in regards to the regional threat. In March 1961, Kennedy voiced a change in policy from supporting a free Laos to a neutral Laos, indicating privately that Vietnam, and not Laos, should be deemed America's tripwire for communism spread in the area. In May 1961, he dispatched Lyndon Johnson to meet with South Vietnam's President Ngo Dinh Diem. Johnson assured Diem more aid to mold a fighting force that could resist the communists. Kennedy announced a change of policy from support to partnership with Diem to defeat of communism in South Vietnam. During his administration, Kennedy continued policies that provided political and economic support, and military advice and support to the South Vietnamese government. Late in 1961, the Viet Cong began assuming a predominant presence, initially seizing the provincial capital of Phuoc Vinh. Kennedy increased the number of military advisors and special forces U.S. special forces in the area, from 11,000 in 1962 to 16,000 by late 1963, but he was reluctant to order a full-scale deployment of troops before his assassination. Kennedy used military advisors and special forces in Vietnam almost exclusively a year and one half later. His successor, President Lyndon Johnson, committed the first combat troops to Vietnam and greatly escalated U.S. involvement, with forces reaching 184,000 that year and 536,000 in 1968. In late 1961, President Kennedy sent Roger Hilsman, then director of the State Department's Bureau of Intelligence and Research, to assess the situation in Vietnam. There, Hilsman met Sir Robert Thompson, head of the British Advisory Mission to South Vietnam, and the concept of the Strategic Hamlet program was formed. It was approved by Kennedy and South Vietnam President Ngo Dinh Diem. It was implemented in early 1962 and involved some forced relocation, village internment, and segregation of rural South Vietnamese into new communities where the peasantry would be isolated from communist insurgents. It was hoped that these new communities would provide security for the peasants and strengthen the tie between them and the central government. By November 1963, the program waned and officially ended in 1964. In early 1962, Kennedy formally authorized escalated involvement when he signed the National Security Action Memorandum. I can't give up that territory to the communists and get the American people to re-elect me. Kennedy faced a crisis in Vietnam by July. Despite increased U.S. support, the South Vietnamese military was only marginally effective against pro-communist Viet Cong forces on August 21, just as the new U.S. Ambassador Henry Cabot Lodge Jr. arrived. Diem and his brother Ngo Dinh Nhu ordered South Vietnam forces, funded and trained by the CIA, to quell Buddhist demonstrations. The crackdowns heightened expectations of a coup d'état to remove Diem with or perhaps by his brother. Nhu Lodge was instructed to try to get Diem and Nhu to step down and leave the country. Diem would not listen to Lodge Cable 243 DEPTEL 243, dated August 24, followed, declaring Washington would no longer tolerate Nhu's actions, and Lodge was ordered to pressure Diem to remove Nhu. If Diem refused, the Americans would explore alternative leadership. Lodge stated that the only workable option was to get the South Vietnamese generals to overthrow Diem and Nhu. As originally planned at week's end, Kennedy learned from Lodge that the Diem government might, due to France's assistance to Nhu, be dealing secretly with the communists, and might ask the Americans to leave. Orders were sent to Saigon and throughout Washington to destroy all coup cables. At the same time, the first formal anti-Vietnam War sentiment was expressed by U.S. clergy from the Ministers' Vietnam Committee. A White House meeting in September was indicative of the very different ongoing appraisals. The president was given updated assessments after personal inspections on the ground by the Department of Defense General Victor Krulik and the State Department Joseph Mendenhall. Krulik said that the military fight against the communists was progressing and being won, while Mendenhall stated that the country was civilly being lost to any U.S. influence. Kennedy reacted, saying, "Did you two gentlemen visit the same country?" The president was unaware that the two men were at such odds that they had not spoken to each other on the return flight in October 1963. The president appointed Defense Secretary McNamara and General Maxwell D. Taylor to a Vietnam mission in another effort to synchronize the information and formulation of policy. The objective of the McNamara-Taylor mission emphasized the importance of getting to the bottom of the differences in reporting from U.S. representatives in Vietnam. In meetings with McNamara, Taylor, and Lodge, Diem again refused to agree to governing measures insisted upon by the U.S., helping to dispel McNamara's previous optimism about Diem. Ayub Khan, president of Pakistan, with U.S. President John F. Kennedy. Taylor and McNamara were also enlightened by Vietnam's vice president, Nguyen Ngoc Tho. Choice of many to succeed Diem should a coup occur, who in detailed terms obliterated Taylor's information that the military was succeeding in the countryside at Kennedy's insistence. The mission report contained a recommended schedule for troop withdrawals, 1,000 by year's end, and complete withdrawal in 1965, something the NSC considered a strategic fantasy. The final report declared that the military was making progress, that the increasingly unpopular Diem-led government was not vulnerable to a coup, and that an assassination of Diem or Nhu was a possibility in late October. Intelligence wires again reported that a coup against the Diem government was afoot. The source, Vietnamese General Duong Van Minh, also known as Big Minh, wanted to know the U.S. position. Kennedy instructed Lodge to offer covert assistance to the coup, excluding assassination, and to ensure deniability by the U.S. later that month. As the coup became imminent, Kennedy ordered all cables to be routed through him. A policy of control and cut out was initiated to ensure presidential control of U.S. responses, while cutting him out of the paper trail. On November 1, 1963, South Vietnamese generals, led by Big Minh, overthrew the Diem government, arresting and then killing Diem and Nhu. Kennedy was shocked by the deaths. He found out afterwards that Minh had asked the CIA field office to secure safe passage out of the country for Diem and Nhu, but was told that 24 hours were needed to procure a plane. Minh responded that he could not hold them. That long news of the coup led to renewed confidence initially, both in America and in South Vietnam, that the war might be won. McGeorge Bundy drafted a National Security Action Memo to present to Kennedy upon his return from Dallas. It reiterated the resolve to fight communism in Vietnam, with increasing military and economic aid and expansion of operations into Laos and Cambodia before leaving for Dallas. Kennedy told Michael Forrestal that, after the first of the year 2008, Theodore Sorensen wrote, "I would like to believe that Kennedy would have found a way to withdraw all American instructors and advisors, but even someone who knew JFK as well as I did can't be certain, because I do not believe he knew in his last weeks what he was going to do." Sorensen added that, in his opinion, Vietnam was the only foreign policy problem handed off by JFK to his successor in no better, and possibly worse, shape than it was when he inherited it. U.S. involvement in the region escalated until Lyndon Johnson, his successor, directly deployed regular U.S. military forces for fighting the Vietnam War after Kennedy's assassination. President Johnson passed NSAM 273 on November 26, 1963. It reversed Kennedy's decision to withdraw 1,000 troops, and reaffirmed the policy of assistance to the South Vietnamese American University. Speech. Kennedy delivers the commencement speech at American University, June 10, 1963. 1963 Wikisource has original text related to this article, A Strategy of Peace World Peace Speech Speech from American University by John F. Kennedy, June 10, 1963 Duration 26-47 Problems playing this file see Media Help. On June 10, 1963, Kennedy delivered at the high point of his rhetorical powers the commencement address at American University in Washington, D.C., also known as Strategy of Peace. Kennedy not only outlined a plan to curb nuclear arms, but also laid out a hopeful, yet realistic route for world peace at a time when the U.S. and Soviet Union faced the potential for an escalating nuclear arms race. The president wished to discuss a topic on which too often ignorance abounds and the truth is too rarely perceived, yet it is the most important topic on earth, world peace. West Berlin speech Ich bin ein Berliner I am a Berliner speech play media Ich bin ein Berliner speech from the Rathaus Schoenberg by John F. Kennedy, June 26, 1963 Duration 901 Ich bin ein Berliner I am a Berliner speech audio only version Duration 922 Kennedy delivering his speech in West Berlin Wikisource has original text related to this article, JFK's Ich bin ein Berliner speech in 1963, Germany was enduring a time of particular vulnerability due to Soviet aggression to the east, and the impending retirement of West German Chancellor Adenauer at the same time, French President Charles de Gaulle was trying to build a Franco-West German counterweight to the American and Soviet spheres of influence to Kennedy's eyes. This Franco-German cooperation seemed directed against NATO's influence in Europe. On June 26, President Kennedy gave a public speech in West Berlin reiterating the American commitment to Germany and criticizing communism. He was met with an ecstatic response from a massive audience. Kennedy used the construction of the Berlin Wall as an example of the failures of communism. Freedom has many difficulties, and democracy is not perfect, but we have never had to put a wall up to keep our people in, to prevent them from leaving us. The speech is known for its famous phrase, Ich bin ein Berliner. I am a citizen of Berlin. A million people were on the street for the speech, he remarked to Ted Sorensen afterwards. We'll never have another day like this one, as long as we live. See also, tear down this wall. Israel in 1960, Kennedy stated, Israel will endure and flourish. It is the child of hope and the home of the brave. It can neither be broken by adversity nor demoralized by success. It carries the shield of democracy and it honors the sword of freedom. Subsequently, as president, Kennedy initiated the creation of security ties with Israel, and he is credited as the founder of the U.S.-Israeli military alliance, which would be continued under subsequent presidents. Kennedy ended the arms embargo that the Eisenhower and Truman administrations had enforced on Israel, describing the protection of Israel as a moral and national commitment. He was the first to introduce the concept of a special relationship, as he described it to Golda Meir, between the U.S. and Israel. Kennedy with Israeli Foreign Minister Golda Meir, December 27, 1962. Kennedy extended the first informal security guarantees to Israel in 1962 and, beginning in 1963, was the first U.S. president to allow the sale to Israel of advanced U.S. weaponry, the MiG-23 Hawk, as well as to provide diplomatic support for Israeli policies which were opposed by Arab neighbors, such as its water project on the Jordan River. As a result of this newly created security alliance, Kennedy also encountered tensions with the Israeli government over the production of nuclear materials in Dimona, which he believed could instigate a nuclear arms race in the Middle East after the existence of a nuclear plant was initially denied by the Israeli government. David Ben-Gurion stated in a speech to the Israeli Knesset on December 21, 1960, that the purpose of the nuclear plant at Beersheba was for research in problems of arid zones and desert flora and fauna. When Ben-Gurion met with Kennedy in New York, he claimed that Dimona was being developed to provide nuclear power for desalinization and other peaceful purposes for the time being. When Kennedy wrote that he was skeptical and stated, in a May 1963 letter to Ben-Gurion, that American support to Israel could be in jeopardy if reliable information on the Israeli nuclear program was not forthcoming, Ben-Gurion repeated previous reassurances that Dimona was being developed for peaceful purposes. The Israeli government resisted American pressure to open its nuclear facilities to International Atomic Energy Agency IAEA inspections in 1962. The U.S. and Israeli governments had agreed to an annual inspection regime, a science attaché at the Embassy in Tel Aviv concluded that parts of the Dimona facility had been shut down temporarily to mislead American scientists when they visited. According to Seymour Hersh, the Israelis set up false control rooms to show the Americans. Israeli lobbyist Abe Feinberg stated, "It was part of my job to tip them off that Kennedy was insisting on." Hersh contends the inspections were conducted in such a way that it guaranteed that the whole procedure would be little more than a whitewash, as the president and his senior advisors had to understand. The American inspection team would have to schedule its visits well in advance, and with the full acquiescence of Israel. Mark Trachtenberg argued, although well aware of what the Israelis were doing, Kennedy chose to take this as satisfactory evidence of Israeli compliance with America's non-proliferation policy. The American who led the inspection team stated that the essential goal of the inspections was to find ways to not reach the point of taking action against Israel's nuclear weapons program. Roger Davies, the director of the State Department's Office of Near Eastern Affairs, concluded in March 1965 that Israel was developing nuclear weapons. He reported that Israel's target date for achieving nuclear capability was 1968-1969. On May 1, 1968, Undersecretary of State Nicholas Katzenbach told President Johnson that Dimona was producing enough plutonium to produce two bombs a year. The State Department argued that if Israel wanted arms, it should accept international supervision of its nuclear program. Dimona was never placed under IAEA safeguards. Attempts to write Israeli adherence to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty NPT into contracts for the supply of U.S. weapons continued throughout 1968. Iraq Main Article, Foreign Policy of the John F. Kennedy Administration Section. British troops were withdrawn and replaced by a 4,000-strong Arab League force in December 1961. Qasim's government passed Public Law 80, which restricted the British and American-owned Iraq Petroleum Company IPC's concessionary holding to those areas in which oil was actually being produced, effectively expropriating 995% of the IPC concession. U.S. officials were alarmed by the expropriation, as well as the recent Soviet veto of an Egyptian-sponsored UN resolution requesting the admittance of Kuwait as UN member state, which they believed to be connected. Senior National Security Council advisor Robert Comer worried that if the IPC ceased production in response, Qasim might grab Kuwait, thus achieving a stranglehold on Middle Eastern oil production, or throw himself into Russian arms. Comer also made note of widespread rumors that a nationalist coup against Qasim could be imminent, and had the potential to get Iraq back on more neutral keel. In April 1962, the State Department issued new guidelines on Iraq that were intended to increase American influence there. Meanwhile, Kennedy instructed the CIA, under the direction of Archibald Bullock Roosevelt Jr., to begin making preparations for a military coup against Qasim. The anti-imperialist and anti-communist Iraqi Ba'ath Party overthrew and executed Qasim in a violent coup on February 8, 1963. While there have been persistent rumors that the CIA orchestrated the coup, declassified documents and the testimony of former CIA officers indicate that there was no direct American involvement. Although the CIA was actively seeking a suitable replacement for Qasim within the Iraqi military and had been informed of an earlier Ba'athist coup plot, the Kennedy administration was pleased with the outcome and ultimately approved a $55 million arms deal for Iraq. Ireland President Kennedy in motorcade in Patrick Street, Cork, in Ireland on June 28, 1963. During his four-day visit to his ancestral home of Ireland in June 1963, Kennedy accepted a grant of armorial bearings from the Chief Herald of Ireland and received honorary degrees from the National University of Ireland and Trinity College, Dublin. He visited the cottage at Dungannstown, near New Ross, County Wexford, where his ancestors had lived before emigrating to America. He also became the first foreign leader to address the Houses of the Oireachtas, the Irish Parliament, on December 22, 2006. The Irish Department of Justice released declassified police documents indicating that security was heightened as Kennedy was the subject of three death threats during this visit. Nuclear Test Ban Treaty Main Article, Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. Troubled by the long-term dangers of radioactive contamination and nuclear weapons proliferation, Kennedy and Khrushchev agreed to negotiate a nuclear test ban treaty, originally conceived in Adlai Stevenson's 1956 presidential campaign. In their Vienna summit meeting in June 1961, Khrushchev and Kennedy reached an informal understanding against nuclear testing, but the Soviet Union began testing nuclear weapons that September. The United States responded by conducting tests 5 days later. Shortly thereafter, new U.S. satellites began delivering images which made it clear that the Soviets were substantially behind behind the U.S. in the arms race nevertheless. The greater nuclear strength of the U.S. was of little value as long as the USSR perceived itself to be at parity. In July 1963, Kennedy sent W. Averill Harriman to Moscow to negotiate a treaty with the Soviets. The introductory sessions included Khrushchev, who later delegated Soviet representation to Andrei Gromyko. It quickly became clear that a comprehensive test ban would not be implemented, due largely to the reluctance of the Soviets to allow inspections that would verify compliance. Ultimately, the United States, the United Kingdom, and the Soviet Union were the initial signatories to a limited treaty, which prohibited atomic testing on the ground, in the atmosphere, or underwater, but not underground. The U.S. Senate ratified this and Kennedy signed it into law in October 1963. France was quick to declare that it was free to continue developing and testing its nuclear defenses. List of international trips. Kennedy made 8 international trips during his presidency. Dates, country, locations, details. 101, May 16-18, 1961. Attended Conference of Presidents of the Central American Republics. 8-11, June 23-25, 1963. Galway, Limerick. Addressed Irish Parliament. Visited ancestral home. 14, June 29-30, 1963.